Hi folks, Tom Coy with, it's not the last episode, but it's the last episode I'm going to be hosting personally, all right, of the Ann Arbor Shield. And before I forget, it's been a pleasure hosting it for the last 3 years. And today in the studio, we have my partner who works with me out of community engagement, Doug Martell. And Trika was nice enough to join us, and for the second time on the show, and she was just trying to wolf down her lunch before she came in here, and we appreciate you being here. And if I didn't say your last name, Zybek, Trika Zybek is a good people. Is that pronounced that right?
Zybek,
sorry.
Whatever.
No, we don't go. Anyhow.
Too many consonants.
Right.
And last is Brett Paddock, who's also joined us in community engagement for the next 3 years. So they are in studio. What we are going to discuss today is what I would like to call maybe law enforcement 101. So we're going to start at the beginning of just the basics. You know, why do officers want to become officers kind of thing? And then kind of take you to where we all find ourselves now in our careers, and including myself, with seeing the horizon of mine end. So having said all that, we will now cut to a great clip I found. So with that, we'll go.
Who would want to do the job? Yeah, you're fighting crime and helping victims. It's just sometimes it feels the other way around. The job is being spat on by the people you're arresting, and sometimes the people you're helping. Turning up when no one else will. Being left holding the baby, or the casualty, or the inmate. The job is being slaughtered in the media for the mistakes of a few of us, amongst, what, 50,000? Being attacked for doing too much stop and search, and too little. You're supposed to leave the job in the locker. Yeah, right. It becomes how you see the world. Their job. That car's job. North Face, jeans, Timberlands, he's definitely job. Can be action and adrenaline. But it's 2% excitement, 98% routine. But if no one did this or that job, no one could do the job. It's too much paperwork, too much no realistic prospect of conviction, and too much being called out because someone won't share the TV remote. The job is why you missed your kid's school nativity and your soon-to-be ex's birthday. The job can be comedy. The job is growing a thick skin and wearing a stab vest over the top. It's suspecting anyone you meet, but trusting everyone you work with. The job is for some what you live for. And for three officers last year, what they died for. The job is going to war on the gangs and the thugs and the thieves, and that feels good. The job is hearing a victim's relief when officers arrive. It's stopping things happening, and because they don't happen, no one knows how bad it would have been. Except other old Bill, who'd rather rip it out of you than pat you on the back, and you do the same, and it's a laugh, and that's the job. But despite all the danger and the distrust, despite all you have to see and do without, those who do it wouldn't want to do any other job.
Okay. Now that one, it gets me, man. All right, so we're going to take a 5 minute thought. I'll try to come up with a joke because I can see it affected all of us. You know, there's something about, well, number one, let's face it, the accent's killer. I mean, that's outstanding. And number two, I thought it was really cool that, you know, they're halfway across the world, but police work's, I mean, we've always said that, right? I mean, police work's police work. It doesn't matter where you do it or what country you're in. But so much of what the narrator says, when I first heard it, was like, wow. I mean, he has just total command of each sentence. And when you listen to it as an officer, anyhow, you're like, yeah, I get it. I mean, the one part where he says, yeah, you're supposed to leave, you know, what you do after 8, 10, 12 hours in the locker. Yeah, right. You know, I mean, it's so true. Anyhow, all right, so let's discuss the film and what your thoughts were. I jotted some stuff down that really resonated with me. 98% excitement, 2% boredom. You know, I mean, I started in police work as an auxiliary officer after I rode two or three years voluntarily. And it would never cease to amaze me that you know, nothing would happen. It's a small town. Nothing would happen. I'd come back the following week and be like, well, you know, how'd the rest of the shift go? Good, man, I got a gun, you know, right after you left. But usually it was just routine. You know, you're patrolling, you're issuing citations or what have you. Any comment on the 98.2% from anybody?
Well, I just want to clarify. So 98% excitement, 2% downtime.
It's
a little backwards.
It depends what police recruiter you're talking to.
Right.
But it is.
Let's be real.
No one else could narrate that, right, but a cop. No, I mean, I don't care who you have, but he encapsulates everything. I like the part where he says, you know, they call us because who else is going to show up? I mean, who else are you going to show, you know, call 911 for to show up on this crime or fighting over the TV remote, as he says, which isn't unfortunately that true or false. But anyhow, any comment on that one? I'm working it hard, folks. But
well, I had kind of a two different reactions at the same time. One is that just the reality of what he's speaking to.
Yeah.
You know, from just a thoughtful standpoint, you know, yeah, we do leave it, we try to leave it at right. work, but it really doesn't work out that way right. so much. Right. But from the get-go, I really felt my heart was just beating. Everything just got more elevated. It was very powerful.
Yeah, I thought so too.
You know, from an emotional standpoint, just, you know, seeing what they're doing, and, you know, all of us have lived that to some degree through our work. And then just listening to him, you know, powerfully narrate that and each little detail that he was talking about, you know.
I looked at a lot, and you know me. I mean, Doug sits right in the same cubicle, so I'm always pouring over these YouTube clips, pouring over. And I went through a lot of them, and most of them were, you know, obviously from the States. And I have to tell you, man, it's, you know, and they make it look like a commercial for TV or something. But this was just... just resonates. You two have not spoken yet. I want to point that out to the audience. Yeah.
I did.
Well, that's right. You did. That's right. You took a jab. Okay.
Here's my cynical. I actually thought the parts that I picked up on were, this is why you missed your kid's game and your soon-to-be ex-wife's birthday.
Yes, I caught that.
Yeah. And what actually threw me off was the three that lost their life last year. Where for us, what is that like times?
Right.
Right. You know,
100. No, you're right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Anything, Brett?
So, yeah, I agree with them. Moving on.
No, Brett's got this down.
I think that they both hit the nail on the head. That, just like Doug was saying, right when we started watching it, you know, the stress kind of started building and building and building. And that's hard to calculate and tell a recruit. Get ready for the stress, you know, dump that you're going to have going to this, you know, exciting call or whatnot. But it's something difficult to to really kind of relate to, I guess. But for me, right when I saw that, my stress level started creeping up a little bit.
Absolutely. I get it. I promised you each, these are all what we call FTOs, field training officers. And so they train the new recruits when we get them. And now how long is it total for training? Six months?
Close to it, yeah.
6 months? Minimum. So they see all the fresh recruits come in. And so my question to each one of you, and you can answer it however you wish. This is what you're asking. No. And what's different, I guess, what I've seen since I've been here is we're hiring a lot more seasoned officers. I mean, with 10, 15 years on from major metropolitan areas in Michigan and outside of Michigan. But having said that, what do you see in the majority of recruits that you take aboard? Or, yeah, I mean, I guess that's the best way to say it. I mean, what stands out to you maybe with, and when I say that, I'm talking about brand new recruits, maybe that have never done police work before. What do you see within them? You know what I mean? Why are they there? Why are they doing police work? Why aren't they working for, you know, Google or what have you? I mean, is there a common denominator, I guess, with these recruits? Or, I mean, are they all over the board as to why they're here and why they want to do police work?
I would say probably similar to us, like when you first come in, you have this idea of what the job is. That changes after a couple of years, but a lot of people aren't office people, you know, the changing environment, being in the car, all that kind of stuff. So an eagerness to kind of see what, if the job lives up to their expectations, I would say.
Real quick, was that, expound on that.
I mean, like, I think when people have an idea of what they think this job actually is, going to, like, is it 98% excitement,
gotcha,
2% downtime?
Gotcha.
No, it's really like 2% excitement, 98% downtime.
Gotcha.
But we're so accustomed to law and order and all that kind of stuff. Like,
gotcha.
So I think what you see a lot of times is just this bright-eyed, is this going to be what I think it's going to be kind of thing right in the beginning.
And so we all look at each other and go, gosh, that used to be me.
Right.
All right. Who's next?
Yeah, I think that when they come on, they're pretty full speed ahead, and you know that's there's a lot of open eyes.
Sure.
In the first, and I was one of them when I started my first police job. I was in a small town too, and I quickly realized how little the police academy prepared me for what I was going to do.
Good point.
Just you know the you know. Speaking with people in crisis and people that are having the worst day of their lives, and then you know trying to make some semblance of order out of complete chaos was particularly challenging. And I don't think that I shouldn't say I don't think, but I think that there's a number of them that come in, and when they see that and they think, how am I going to manage my way through this quagmire?
Yeah.
It can be pretty eye-opening.
Yeah.
And when they come from just a very stable, normal,
what
they would call normal household, and then they're interjected into these situations with lots of family dynamics, and it's very eye-opening for some of them. And you know, the ones that have come from other police departments, I like to say that the blue has sunken in, it's soaked in a little bit, so they have an idea of how to navigate those kinds of things. And but you know, folks that are right out of the police academy, it can be pretty eye opening. Me is one of them when I first started.
Yeah,
it's a big deal.
I share a story along that same line from mine. I'm going to make. We got 2 minutes, so I'm going to shoot a question to you, Brad.
Okay.
Do you believe, being from an FTO standpoint, do you believe you either are a police officer? That is to say, there's something within you that you can argue all day long if it's negative or positive, but something within you that is different than everyone else and is going to make you a good police officer versus, well, you know what, with enough training, with enough this and enough that, I can make you a good police officer. I mean, do you think it's innate? Do you think?
I think that you have to be kind of wired or have some type of DNA,
yeah,
really.
Yeah.
To, and I love the video, but there's more to it than just the whatever we just saw. But I think from a personal standpoint, you do have to have some type of DNA to want to help, to want to help everybody, to have great communication. Depending on the environment, the city, township, state, the folks that you're protecting and serving, to have that ability to communicate with everybody on a high level.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think you definitely have to have a DNA ingrained with you to become a cop. So,
which is the mystery as to why I'm still here after 25, 28 total. But anyhow, all right, we're gonna watch our second video. Hopefully it won't be as emotional as the first one. Go ahead, Bud. Peers are looking at me saying, what in the world was that all about? What I wanted to do was take us all back to the day, we took the oath, or not took the oath, but finished the academy. What was our mindset during the academy? Where was the academy? Why were you in the academy? That kind of thing. So I figured take us back, right? Getting a lot of dirty
looks.
That's
a long time for me,
getting a lot of dirty looks. So this time I'll start off to give you kind of whatever, because I can see I'm going to have some issues here. I went through in 1986. I was working full-time at the time at Steelcase, actually. It was something I decided I wanted to do after being an auxiliary officer for a couple years. So I would work midnights at Steelcase, get off, go to the academy till 2 or 3 in the afternoon, go home, sleep, and repeat that. And no, I wouldn't be able to. I'd probably do that one day now. But my older brother was a huge influence. He worked for the city of Kalamazoo at the time. And the first time I rode a midnight shift, I don't know. I mean, you guys have your own experiences, but I was hooked. I was like, oh my goodness, this was like a totally different world than I'd ever known before. So you're out, in my opinion, looking for evil, dealing with evil, helping, the folks that are out there needing assistance. But that's all I wanted to do. and I'll end it by saying this, so that when I decided to go full-time, and it was a small town, and at Steelcase I was making a very good wage, I had a family at the time, and I wrestled with what to do for so long because it was a pay cut. I finally went and saw somebody, and he assured me that I would live, you know, with the less money. I gave notice at Steelcase, came home, told my wife then, I quit, and I'm going to be starting at this small town, making about one-third of what I did before. It took a couple weeks to work that out, so I wouldn't suggest that. But anyhow, so that was my story. And I think I was the oldest guy in the class, actually, at the time. Who's up?
Similar story for me. What partially got me going, in a big way, was that I had a college class, and it was taught by a sheriff's deputy. And he offered up, and it wasn't mandatory, but you could go for ride-alongs with him. And so I went on a ride-along, and it was like, yeah, this is cool. I like this. You know, this I wasn't the kind of person that was going to, sit around and shuffle paper or anything like that. So it was just, that was pretty much made for me. Went to a police academy, probably different than you guys. I went to Fair State, so they integrated all our police academy training into the last 2 years of a bachelor's degree. So it wasn't like an intense like the video.
Right.
I mean, there was still PT and all the things that go with it. It was just kind of split up, so it wasn't super, super intense like that. I wasn't married at the time when I got my first police job in 1989. So because I went. I started the police academy in 1987. So, but yeah, it was that's pretty much how it got me going in it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Do we even want to go here with you, Trika?
I already answered this question, so we'll go back to a couple episodes ago, and we'll say Jodie Foster, Silence of the Lambs.
Just a quick synopsis for the sake of our audience.
That's what I wanted to be when I grew up.
Okay.
And then in the meantime, while I was going to school, I needed a job, so I came here as a civilian, and I worked the lovely front desk.
I don't remember that.
At which point I thought to myself, why am I doing this when I could be doing that? Went to the academy, and the rest was downhill.
I don't remember you working the front desk, man.
Really?
I don't.
Yeah, light blue shirts. I don't know, 4 or 5 months.
Yeah, I was going to say, okay, that's why I remember.
I left pretty quickly, went to the academy, and then came back when I got out of the academy.
She was still 14 reports down when she came back.
True, true.
For those of you out there saying, boy, you'd think after working with somebody for 20, 25 years, you'd know your colleagues a little bit better. And I would just say, the average officer will leave here not knowing his colleagues really at all. You know what I mean? When push comes to shove, we're there for each other, obviously. But everybody walks around with that cop. Well, it's another story, but anyway, go ahead, Brett.
Went to the academy in 94, and before that I was with the park system, with the DNR, and so I ended up having a lot of contacts with the Washtenaw County Sheriff Department, some of the state officers, the conservation officers, so that was my kind of direction I was going to go. After the academy, kind of blossomed into, Ann Arbor PD and other sheriff departments, and this is where I landed, so. Very happy I did, but yeah, long time ago, seems like.
Doesn't it though?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What do we got here? Almost 100 years of, between the four of us, right?
Right, yeah.
I'm trying to think of any other good questions, but I'm trying to put us all in that mode, where you're, I think somebody mentioned it here earlier, God, man, I just remember working, and if you would have paid me $5 an hour with no benefits, I would have done it. I wouldn't even have questioned it. I was just, it was a lot of fun, and I'm hearing the naysayers, yeah, you get, it's like you know anything, you didn't do it. I was just enthused and passionate, and it was all I thought about most of the time, and I know, as you're sitting here going, really, you? I mean, when you work a small town, you either make it happen and look for trouble, or you wait for a call, and all right, we will cut to our last clip and bring in a little bit of reality. I think you'll enjoy it.
Today, you are officially a police officer.
This is something I've been waiting for my whole life, so I'm just super excited. I can't get the smile off my face. That was Officer Jose Rivera. We met him and two fellow officers 3 years ago. Since that time, much has happened in our city and the nation to spark tension between the police and the public. So how has that impacted Rivera and his fellow officers? In this original report, CBS2's Mai Martinez sits down with him.
What do you think is the hardest thing about being a police officer in the city of Chicago?
It's a struggle for me with the violence you see, the kids in the community that you see also, you know, viewing all this violence.
And not really being able to try to help them as much as you can, but then at the end of your tour, you're going home. So he has to stay there, or she has to stay there.
It just seems like with all this, these violent crimes, and most of your teens and young adults are committing a crime, it seems like we're losing so many generations.
You didn't realize it would be as bad on the streets as it is.
No, as when you become an officer and you become on the other side of the law, the filters come off, the blinders come off, and you see things differently.
And helping can be difficult because of another reality, the code of silence.
Trying to be there for a crime that took place and trying to figure out what happened here, who's involved, and no one being willing to help you come forward.
It's frustrating in some aspects. And then in other aspects, I get it, because these people have to live in these communities, so they might be, you know, afraid to reach out.
Another challenge the officers face, the growing anti-police sentiment following the deaths of Eric Garner, Michael Brown, Freddie Gray, and Sandra Bland.
When it's black on black crime, they don't say much. But when it's an officer, then they want to say Black Lives Matter. But Black Lives should matter all the time.
I thought that was a good clip. I have this burning a hole. So I ran across this study, as I think is relevant to where law enforcement finds itself in our nation today. This was out of the University of Michigan, actually, in conjunction with two other universities. And this was published last year through the Psychological Science in the Public Interest Journal, which I assume. They found, the study wanted to know, you know, once people believe something, how do we get them to change what they believe based on fact? And in the study, they found some interesting things, of which I jotted down. Misinformation can originate from rumors, but also fiction. Government and politicians and organizations can be the source of that. Ideology and personal worldviews can be major obstacles for changing false beliefs. And finally, the more often people hear a false message, the more likely they are to believe it. And I point that out for obvious reasons, because I think those of us who find ourselves in police work in America in 2017 probably find ourselves frustrated sometimes with the accusations being hurled without knowing the person in the uniform, number one. And number two, even when facts are brought forth that totally, you know, defeat what other people are alleging, it's like, you know, there's no recognition there of the facts. It's all about feeling, you know what I mean? And as an officer, I'm speaking only for myself, that is very frustrating. You know, if I say 1 + 1 = 2, and you come back with, well, not really, because, you know what I mean? I mean, it's like, wow. How did we get here? But anyhow, so we looked at, we've been back to the academy thing. All of us have a lot of years on. And in light of the clip, in light of the study, there are challenges, you know, in police work that none of us have seen before. So I'm going to risk, big risk, I'm going to risk asking the question. And again, I'll start, because I think someone's got to be the sacrificial lamb. How do you do effective policing in America now, do it well, and not become cynical, angry, and even bitter when, you know, you're accused of being all these, you know, different adjectives that don't even apply to you? I've been doing it 28 years total, and I've seen other periods of time that law enforcement has gone through this. The only thing I tell myself is that I have to do the police work that I'm going to do for the next 8 hours, 10 hours. For me, for my faith, that's a huge part of my life. But essentially, if I'm doing any portion of it for recognition or accolades or even, you know, an attaboy from my superiors, I guarantee you it wouldn't take long and I would be absolutely defeated, angry, and bitter. So at the end of the day, for me, it's all about looking in the mirror saying, hey, did you do the best you could today? Did, you know, and remain as objective as a human being can be and still do your job. And that's how I do police work, the best I can. And I don't always do it well, but that's what I hang my head on.
I think the best way I can sum that up is, wasn't too long after I started here in Ann Arbor. It was probably in the late 90s, because I started in 95. There was a little turmoil in the police department with some things going on with the chief, and there were some lawsuits going on, and I was a relatively new employee. And a long-term employee came up to me, she happened to be a civilian, and, you know, very caring person. And, you know, she asked me, she said, you know, how is this, is this affecting you, what's going on in the police department? And, you know, you're pretty new here, and I was curious as to see how this was making you feel with all the things that are going on. I said, you know, I said, these folks inside this building, they're my bosses, and I respect them, and, you know, I hold them in high regard. But I don't work for them. I work for the people that live in the city and visit the city, that come through the city. They're the ones that I work for. And so that was, you know, and that's how I said that wholeheartedly. That's the way I felt then, and that's the way I feel now. And yeah, you can let all those things that happen to you during your shift or whatever, it can wear you down. But if you try to keep things in perspective, you know, because let's be honest, there's a lot of stress that comes from the job, from within the building that we work.
Yeah, for sure.
And you know, so if you can try to separate yourself from that and work for the people out and that you're there to serve, I think that's what's been, you know, that's how I kind of sum it up for how I've been able to work through it over the years.
Don't even go there, Tree, because I know you're one of those officers that goes above and, I mean, I get, you know, stuff from you that you take the time, you want to know what's going on in this person's life and what you can do more than just, you know, the usual. So don't even play that with me. I know that you give 110%. But anyhow, go ahead.
So to address public perception, I think you kind of hit it on the head. We do what we do. We do it the best that we can do it. And I think if you do it as legitimately as you can from good intention, you know, people are always going to say things. It is what it is, and you just can't internalize it. Everybody's going to get angry and have knee-jerk reactions to the things that we see or that we're called or that we have to face. This too shall pass, I guess.
Yeah.
Like, it is what it is. I come here every day to do what I can do, but my passion and my heart is to be at home with my family. That's where I focus my energy on. There's no sense getting upset and angry about internal things or external things here. It is what it is.
Yeah.
It's hard to come up with other things, but, you know, being the last to answer, but
I tried to
hang it up. I know. I should have taken it, but, you know, I think that transparency is a really big thing as far as when you look at some of the problems facing policing in America right now, you see that that coming up as a question, whether, and I think Ann Arbor is a great place where that is, in my personal opinion, it is not that big of a problem. I mean, we are very open to mm-hmm. what we investigate and what we release too, but I think the other side of that is having good communication with the public and answering and being able to, like what we do in community engagement, engaging your society or your community. So I think that's very important for us to do and continue to do the way we do it here in Ann Arbor. So,
All right, so we're going to end with this one. As you're talking, I'm going to, anyhow, maybe a funny story from when you first started policing, all right? So I will start because I know you're looking, well, hey, man, I'm not going to say. So I'm back working in the small town. Two things, actually. This was my first arrest. My first arrest in Coopersville. It was like 2 or 3 in the morning, and it was going to be a drunk driving arrest. And I was on the expressway, and I had him out for dexterities evaluations, and it was too close between two of our cars. So I said, stay standing right here, and I'm going to back up and give us a little bit. So I backed up my car. Of course, we all know what happened. He took off running across the expressway. You know, here I am chasing this guy 2 or 3 in the morning, all because of my stupidity of not having enough space there. But I also remember this, as clear as day. This is the best job in the world. I got him, by the way. But anyhow, and then I stopped a guy one time, expressway again. And for some reason, I asked him, do you have any contraband or weapons in the car? He goes, yeah. He says, I got a pistol in the glove box. I said, well, hand it over, man. You know, and I told that story to a deputy after the fact. He goes, let's talk a minute. But that, you know, we talked about that earlier, is that, hey, man, I had been a civilian a long time, worked in different jobs, and that's the way you're operating. You figure people are going to tell you the truth, that everybody's on the straight up, you know, and then you find out very, very, very quickly as, was it this one? Yeah, the filters come off, right? I mean, it doesn't take very long, and the filters better come off. If you're going to survive working in police work, you better not have that attitude of, well, you know, because you aren't going to last long. Anyhow, any other good stories?
Well, I just wanted to hit on a point you made. Was that was probably one of the hardest things I had to adjust to when I started in police work, was the fact that you got lied to so much.
Yeah,
it was hard to swallow.
The fact that
you'll talk to these people and they will just bold-faced lie to you.
Yeah.
So that was something I had to get over. And you get over it pretty quick. You slide that cynicism into there a little bit.
Yeah.
And then you just don't believe anybody, right?
Absolutely. Well, I mean, right? Because it's not based on social class or education.
No, they just,
it has
they
nothing
just,
to do with it. It's no, just, they just lie they to just get. Lie anyhow.
I was working, this is the one that I can come up with real quick off the top of my head. I stopped this guy, I'm working in the small town. And this guy's driving down the main road, and I stop him. He's pulling a boat, and there's no. I'm looking for something because I'm
sure.
new, and I
yep,
I,
yep,
I,
yep.
I got to do something. And he doesn't have a plate on his trailer, all right. And then the lights aren't working on his trailer, so he's pulling this boat. So I stop him, and he jumps out of the truck and starts to reach into the bed of the truck.
Mm.
And so my mind's thinking, oh,
sure.
This guy's going to pull a rifle out or something. And so I jump out of the car and tell him, you know, if I'm pulling my gun, and I'm telling him to get back in his truck, and I didn't put my car in park, and it's closing in on his boat.
I
did manage to, you know, throw it into park and stop it, like this far from the back of his boat. But and he was getting his plate. He had his plate
Got
in
it.
The back bed of the truck for the trailer.
Right. Get
it. Yeah. That could have been.
Come on, don't hold on the street. Got to be one in there somewhere.
One of my favorites was a long time ago when I still, you know, chased people, which we don't do anymore. Seeing somebody in one of the neighborhoods with a warrant who took off running, undoubtedly, you know, he was going to get caught because he was a big fella, but he took the time to stash his weed on the tire of a car that he ran past, like with us within 25 feet of him. I was like, well, that was really cute. That was creative. We saw that.
Yeah.
That was probably one of my more memorable ones. Like, really?
I love it.
Well, I got one from, I think it was week 2 or 3 of FTO, FTOing, and my partner to be in the future. We're on midnights riding together with our FTOs, and I remember it was a hot night, and my FTO had pulled up to the other FTO, and me being a recruit, and my future partner being a recruit, he was driving, so we were paired up door to door. And just out of, I don't know where it came from, but he rolled up the window and his training officer had his hand.
Oh, no
outside
doubt.
The, and to this day, I'm in tears laughing at the reaction of both of them, because my future partner just kept on rolling up the window and just smashed the fingers of the training officer.
Was that on the DOR?
That's
a bad evaluation.
Right, yeah.
Oh, man.
My FTO and myself, we were in tears, just laughing hysterically. But never forget that.
Welcome to police work. Yeah. Okay, I see we're out of time. Thank each one of you. Now, wasn't that bad, was it?
It was good.
All right. Thanks for joining us on my last hosting of this show. And next month, it'll be these guys doing the thing. So it's been a pleasure. I appreciate the opportunity to have done it. And I hope maybe in a small, tiny way, you see police officers in a better light, maybe since you started watching, maybe. Anyhow, with that, we'll bid you adieu till next month. Thanks for watching.